Hey, this is Ronald Carroll from Mad Skills University. Today we're going to learn how to do DaVinci Resolve. So let's get started. I'm going to go up here. I want to make sure that on the playback, I have used Optimized Media Check. I also want to go over here to Workplace. And if I want to use a dual screen, I can turn that on right here. Over under DaVinci Resolve, of course, I can check for updates. Here I can customize my shortcuts, and you're gonna do that. Under preferences, general things for just about everything, media storage, the whole nine yards, you can check that off here. If you have a GPU, a graphic processing unit, on your laptop or MacBook or whatever, use that and don't use the CPU. And user changes here, just basic stuff, you can read through that. But what's really important though is down here. So if I press home key, it's gonna take me back to a new project, just so you know. I can close that. If I click on this icon here, I'll get my preferences. The first one I'll see is, of course, my resolution, my format, my frames per second. I can change all that here. And I can save it as well. New here is I can use vertical resolution. So if I'm trying to create a video short, like for YouTube or for TikTok, you want to make sure your video is vertical. And that could be your standard format. Here, when you're dealing with optimized media or proxies, what that really means is that they'll take the resolution and they'll decrease the resolution. So this way your rendering and playback is a lot smoother. You can still export or deliver at a higher resolution, but that's what that basically means. And you can check out whatever codec or whatever resolution format you're using or media you're using. You can change that. And if you have a system that's a little bit slower, I would go over here and optimize all my media to be at half or quarter. Don't go full or original. So that will help you if your system is having a hard time processing. And then, of course, here's where I save my files. You can go through each one of these things. But down here in Fairlight, you want to make sure that you change your target right level, your loudness level, dBs. Make sure your dBs are between minus 13 and minus 15. But this is where you can change a lot of things right up in here. You can save that. Down here we have seven pages or modules. So this first module is really just for my imaging. I can also drag image right here, or drag it to the timeline as well. But this is basically my media manipulation page. Smart bins are bins that if I know I use my logo, my subscribe button, things I use commonly, my music, I can create a smart bin and throw all that stuff in there. So it's always available to me. I don't have to go try to find that. For more on smart bins, check out YouTube videos on specific things because that's how DaVinci Resolve is, everything specific. This will be my cut screen. If I want to do specific cuts and cut all day and trim all day. And some people, that's their job. Edit page. You can spend most of your time over here on the edit page. So I can turn something on or turn it off just by clicking on it. If it's white, it's on. Or if it's grayed out, it's not on. This will be my Fusion page, but you want to roll your sleeves up on that. But it's really cool to work with because you're working with notes, and they're a lot easier to work with once you get the gist of it. Color grading, color correction, this thing does everything. And DaVinci Resolve is known for color grading. Fairlight is music. So if you're an audiophile and you into music, and you know what all this stuff means already. You have effects up here. You can bring down special things like echo and delay and the whole nine yards. Then, of course, when you're done with your project, you want to render that project. And you can do that right here. If you're working in, you know, Final Cut Pro or Adobe Premiere, you can export to that format as well. YouTube, Vimeo, whatever you want to do, it's all right here. You can also go vertical, so keep that in mind. If you're doing a short, it's going to be, you know, vertical and not horizontal. Something else we want to do before we get started is go up here to playback to where it says timeline proxy resolution and make sure it's full. Now, if you don't have a high-end system, take it to half or quarter. Also, you want to go to render cache and make sure it's on smart. You can also look at deleting anything that's already done, any old projects. And then, of course, make sure that Fusion memory cache is on auto. And that's it. Something you also want to do is after you're done working with the project, you bring in new projects, you want to go up here to Workspace and come down to Reset UI Layout. So that's going to take everything back to the way it originally started. I don't want dual monitors, so I'm going to come over here. and switch it back to single mode. I really don't need dual monitors right now. But if you're doing pre-editing for a clip that's coming next, you can cut that clip in the dual monitor. If I wanted to take a snapshot of this picture, what I would do is go over here to colors down here. I'm going to go over this a little bit more later. I'm going to bring this down over here. And what I'll do is I'll right-click on the video. I'll click on Grab Still. The still comes over here in my gallery. On, off, on. I'll right-click on that. I'll come down to Export. And now I can export that. Ping, JPEG, whatever I want. And I'll bring that JPEG. But you're going to have to go over here to Colors and then just go ahead and grab Still. And then export. Let's go over here to our edit module or edit page. We're going to bring in a couple of videos here. We're going to keep that the same and we're going to bring in some surfers and we'll start there. Bring down my paraglider and I'll bring down my surfers and put them on top. And there's my audio. This right here is my snap to tool. If I want to trim this clip, I'll just grab it by the end and just bring it over and snap it and trim it there. Same thing with this audio. I'll snap it there. That's what this tool is, on snap or snap, as you're bringing two video clips together. Here would be my link tool. So these would be linked, audio and video. And if I want to unlink those, I'll uncheck that. Now I just click on the audio and press backspace to get rid of it. If I click on this, it brings everything into the time frame. Makes it longer or smaller. If I hold Alt and scroll down, that's what happens. If I hold Control, it moves the entire timeline. Let's fit it back in. If I hold Shift, that's what that does if I scroll up and down. These are your basic lock it, you know, don't see it, don't see nothing, that kind of thing. I can also make some changes on my timeline here. Let's make this smaller. If I want to create a duplicate of these two files or one of these files, I'll select it, press Alt or Option, and just drag it over. There's my duplicate. Without this on, the snap on, it's going to just roll right through it. With the snap on, it's going to snap play. I'm going to delete both of these, hold Control, and select those two together, and backspace. To get rid of the excess tracks here, I'll go down to Delete Empty Tracks. What I want to do now is I'm going to bring down some text. So let's go back over to our effects. Let's go over to Toolbox, double click that, and go to Titles. And here I have tons of titles. If you run across something that has DaVinci logo on it, that means that's in the studio version, so it's going to say DaVinci Studio. But if I want to see what something looks like, just drag across. Callouts. I mean, you have it, glitches, drop-ins. Let's go up here, just get a basic title. I'm going to see it selected now, left click and grab it and drop it on top of my video. I'm going to drag it out. Simple stuff here. Left click that. Now I go into what they call the inspector. And in the inspector, I can change anything here. So we're going to call this DaVinci Resolve 18. I'm going to go down here. I can change the font, make it bold, change the size, let's make it big. And as you can see, we can do so much to the text. So it's all right here. If I had two text here, something like this, what you'll see are three different boxes. So if I play that, I can stop it. I can also play it back. In basic compositing, we can do stuff like this. So I'm going to bring this above it. I'm going to click on this. I'm going to go over here to Composite. So I'll go down here to Multiply. And now the video is behind the text. You can also do the same thing with photographs. I brought a photo up here. If I want to go up here and insert a track, if I insert a track up here and I brought a photo down, it will be the exact same thing. So just drag it over. And then I can just turn this one off. Click on this. Go down. And darken works as well as dark color. But go down here to multiply, and it works the exact same way. You can change the opacity, things like that. But another way to do this, click on the top picture, hit your backspace key. Let's bring this one back. But now I'm going to do something different. So this is on the bottom and this is on the top. What I'm going to do is I'm going to click on the top picture. I'm going to change it from multiply, and I'm going to change it to foreground. I'm going to click on the bottom picture, and I'm going to go over here to settings, and I'm going to go to compositing, and I'm going to change it to alpha. So go all the way down, and that's the exact same thing. So you're going to see the paraglider come in. But what's cool about this, though, I add a track. So I add a video track on the bottom. Now I'm going to come over here, and I'm going to go back into my media. I'm going to bring this track down below. As you can see now, it's bluish. Now if I click back on here and go back into settings, and I invert that, now I have this video inside the text. So there's a lot of things you can do with this using compositing. This is how you can put video inside text or anything like that, just so you know how to do that. And of course, how to bring up text and play with your text as well too. And that's back over here on the title. Alt to see what I'm doing here. You can get rid of all this stuff. And this is highlighted. So I can also take out the inspector as well. So now we just have nothing but our timeline. I want to quickly talk about the metadata up here as well as font. So if I go over here, I can change anything in here. All I have to do is go over here, click on this option right here to the far right, just click on whatever I want to change and just change it. So keep that in mind. Also with fonts, if I go to effects and come down to titles, and then go over to the last option, which is custom titles, and I pop that in, what you're going to discover that if I go over to inspector and look at fonts, I don't have a whole lot of fonts to work with. But you can go to Google Fonts, thefont.com, or you can go to 1001fonts.com, and you can install those normally in Windows, Mac, like you normally would. If you're inside DR18, you need to exit out and then come back in. And then if you came over here and looked for those fonts, you will find them. Let's do some basic editing. I'm going to go back over here to my edit module page. As you can see, we have different audio files. So I can bring a file down here. And here's a mixer for that. So I can change the audio and I can take the mixer off. As I'm bringing down different video files, I can just bring them down and put them on top. Then I'll bring down another file and we'll put it right there. And it has audio too. So if I do that, I can separate them that way, but they aren't linked. Press backspace on that and bring that file together. Click here and that will fit everything in the timeline. I can mark anywhere in the video right here by clicking the marker or pressing M. I can also change the colors here. You can flag something and change the colors. Your cut, basic cut editing tool is here. Razor blade cuts are here. Click, click. To undo that, hit Control Z, Control Z. Over here, I have basic just audio and video. If I left click inside the audio one, I can change that to anything I want. If I right click in here, I can add a track, and that will be for video. If I right click down in the audio section, and the same thing, it'll be for audio. I can change the way things look up here. This will adjust the track height like I did with these, holding down the shift key and scrolling the mouse up and down, and lock it right there. And just basic stuff along here. As you play, you can play a file here. You can also play backwards. Stop it. If I scroll up, I can see all of my assets over here, but I can change the way that looks, anything I want. I can also turn this on up here or off. I can turn media off where I just have a complete timeline. If I also want to have a dual screen, say I want to edit the clip I'm about to insert, go up here to workspace and come down here to single. And now it's on single view. But if I want two screens, and that's what I had, I'll show you how I did that. Now I turn single off, so I'll have two. Here's how that works. I have a video here. Whatever's on my timeline is going to show to the right. If I bring another video over here, now that's going to show to the left. What's cool about this is that I can edit right here. I can take this along and just see what's going on in that video. I can do the same thing over here. So it's going to show me what's going on in the video. Say I want this to start about right here. Now I can just press I, and I want it to end about right here. I'll press O. So now when I bring that clip down, as you see the lines on the clip? I pre-cut that in this screen. So you see the lines on the clip, that's where it's going to cut. And when I bring it down, that's where it's going to be. So that's how that works. You also want to optimize your media. So what you want to do is go up here and make sure that this is checked. Use optimized media. I can highlight the media. Right click and go down to generate optimized media. What that's going to do, like a proxy file, and you want to use proxies because when you're playing it back, if you have it at full resolution, then it's going to play it back choppy and all that. So what you want to do is optimize it. So it's going to reduce the resolution so you can edit it faster and playback will be smoother. Now when you export or deliver, that's something totally different. Like I told you before, you're going to do a lot of your work here in the edit mode. It's taken a few minutes to do that. That's okay because I am optimizing a lot of files at one time. Okay, stop. Enough with the basics. I can go on forever with this, and it's not really teaching you how to actually use DaVinci Resolve 18 to do projects that look cool, that are a little bit fun. So let's switch it up. We go over here to effects, and again, we have video transitions here. And we have audio transitions. We're not going to use those, but let's go down to video transitions. And then we can easily just grab what we want. Click it and insert it into the video. Here's my transition. Let's grab the end of it here and drag it out. Then I go to inspector. There's my transition. I can change the duration. I can even change what I'm using here, change the curves on it. Let's see what that looks like. Spacebar. So it's slow, so we can speed it up. You can also move it to the other side, like that. Let's see what that looks like. You can also change the colors down here. In and out, fade in. You might want to put that on all your videos, so it's just kind of a way to feather it out and feather it in. But you can change things on here, the border, so on and so forth. And you can keyframe all of this as well. But that's how you apply transitions. And anyone you want to apply, I like the idea of putting a solid color up here too, because I can have two transitions. Let me show you what I mean by that. So I'll go over here to generator. I'll go down here to solid color. I'll grab that and I'll put it right between the two video clips. I'll take this, I'll click on this transition, hit shift backspace to get rid of it. Now what I can do is go back to transitions. And I'll put this on the right side. And we'll stretch it out. And then we'll put this one on the left side, like that. We'll stretch it out. Hold Alt, scroll up to make the clips longer or shorter. Remember that. Now let's go ahead and scroll back over here a little bit by holding Control and going down and up. Now let's see what that looks like. So that's a way of getting a double transition in between two clips. And I still don't like the black around it, so I could go over here as well and kind of have this fade in and fade out a little bit. Then we can change some of the curves on this. Let's see what that looks like. So we can play with those transitions just a little bit. Here's just the end, and then I can switch over to the outside as well. trying to show you a few different things. So that was a hard transition in, and I applied that to the front. Then I'll go back up here, and let's bring down a glitch. Let's put that right there. Let's see what that glitch looks like. So there's my glitch. So you can insert any kind of transition here, including regular glitches or what we call fusion transitions. Wipes, you have shapes. So if you look at the category, we have motion. We have the iris, of course. And we have basic dissolves. We have warps. You have everything here. So you can do anything you do in most video editors right here. And this program is free. Like I said, the learning curve is a little bit longer. But just go through all these. And what you want to do is mark your favorites. That's the number one thing. Mark your favorites. And that way you know where they are. Chromatic aberration. I mean, everything is here. So again, that's a studio version. Okay, so let's show you the correct way to apply a transition. And sometimes if I grab a transition and I really can't put it anywhere, like here I can put it on the left side, but not the right side. And I'll show you what I mean. Let's go ahead and expand that and move it back over. And if I click on that transition and go up here, it's left, can't go right, can't go center. If I click on the end of that video clip, see how it's red? That's telling me now that there's no more rooms. I have to have room to apply a transition between clips. Those clips have to somehow interlap. Let's make sure we are snapping there. That's snapping. And see, that one is red too. That's green, so I can apply it on this side now. Two ways I can do this really quickly. One is to use this tool right here. Click on this tool. And then grab this clip and drag it over. And see how I have white on the left side there? And then do the same to this clip and drag it over. And that's red. So let's go ahead and pull it back. And now I have some overlap like that. So now if I come up and take that transition, it should pop between the two clips like that. And that's how you want your transitions. And of course, I can make that smaller or bigger. But I can also do Control Z and let's click on the transition, Shift and Backspace. And what I can do is just grab this clip and see it's green. So that means I have some room to work with. The other side is red. So I can grab that clip and just bring it back a little bit. Now we have the green-green overlap. So if you see green-green, that means there's enough room on either side of either clip to apply a transition. Let's grab a new transition. Put it between those two transitions. You see it's not rendered, it's red. If you give it a couple of minutes or a couple of seconds, it's going to render. Now it's rendered. It's almost as if a transition is just not an overlay. It's something that you have to create room for. So I want to replace this sky with this paraglider. And this right here will link my audio with my video. So if I want to detach the audio from the video, like these two clips here, I'll uncheck that. And now I can detach the audio, press my backspace key, and that's going to delete the audio. What I want to do is click on the top video that I want to replace the sky with, and I want to go over here to effects. I'm going to type in 3D. And this is filler, so it's coming from open. I'm going to go down to filters, and that's going to give me 3D keyer. I'm going to grab 3D keyer and drop it on top of the video clip. Then I'm going to go up here to this drop-down menu, and I'm going to select Open FX Overlay. Now I'm just going to click here and just drag over. And anything that's black is going to be replaced. Not going to be perfect. Once I'm inside here, I can go up here to Inspector, and now I can find my effect, which is right here, and I can make changes here. Output, you can adjust all this. Key adjustments, output layers. So you can play around with this and get this absolutely perfect if you like. I can press Control or Command plus F as in Frank to go full screen and see what that looks like. It's going to be a little bit choppy, only because, you know, I got these videos going all over the place, but that's kind of what it looks like. And the areas here that are blue, I can go in there inside the editor here with the effects for the 3D keyer, and I can change, I can remove some of this, some of that. So you'll be surprised how much you can do inside this window. So play around with this. There are better videos out there, of course, on this and more extensive ones. But this just gives you an idea of how to do some of this stuff. One quick way that we can turn this into more of a cinematic view is to click on the video clip and then go up here to timeline. Go down here to output blanking and select a different ratio up here. And DaVinci does it for you automatically. You can also go in and change it manually as well. Let's talk about compositing for a minute. Now you can see, if I look at both these videos, they're not formatted the same. So I could change that by clicking on the top video, going over here to my drop-down menu, going to transform, and then just go ahead and drag that video out so it fits the full screen. And that just looks better. And now with compositing, now I can go to the top video clip, click on it, and I can change this to multiply, color burn, and this will allow me to see both of my video clips at the same time. And we'll go to multiply here, and then you can go and change the opacity for any video clip. And sometimes what I'll do is I'll come about right here and I'll put a cut, and then I'll put a dissolve like in between these two clips. So I would take it and take this over here, delete this, and then do a dissolve some kind of way between these two. So you can play with different things here, but once you're here, you can just go down the list of things you can change to foreground, background, vivid light, and just try different things to see what works for you. And that's how we do compositing. Now I'm going to show you how to do a really quick pan and zoom. So click on the video clip you want to pan and zoom into. Go over here again to the square box. Click on the drop down menu. Let's go to dynamic zoom. Here I can do a quick crop. Here I can do a quick transform as well, so I don't have to go up here to transform. And a crop is a basic crop. I can just crop it, grab it in, and just crop the video anywhere I want. But the pan and zoom, let's go back over here. And I'm going to go to dynamic zoom. Now we're going to have two boxes here. One's on the outside, it's red, and one is green. So it's going to start on the red and go into the green as we go along. So you can actually just do this as you go. Let's bring that red back over. And we're going to zoom this in. Let's see what that looks like. So see, it starts inside the green and now it's going back out to the red. Hit Control F as in Frank. Then you can also reverse it. So I can say, let's bring this and make it small. And let's click on our green and take it out to the corners like that. As you can see, it has a line telling you where it's going to go. I can have it go out to this corner and go off the screen as well too, if I want. And let's make it go full screen and put it outside the screen. And let's try that. This is a quick, easy way to do a pan and zoom. Pretty interesting, huh? So there's my red. So it was actually coming out here and going way inside and following the actual paraglider. Also, I can do a dynamic zoom right here as well, too. Let's say, for example, I was timing the people coming across here and I want to bring in some kind of timer. What I would do is I'll go over here to Effects, and I'll go over here to Titles, and I'll come down to here where it says Custom Title. I'll drag that down over my timeline. Then I'll go over here to Inspector. I'll right-click anywhere in this box, and I'll come down to where it says Time Code, and I'll click on that. As you can see, now we have a basic timer. We can change a lot of that up in here, what it does, but to remove things from the left or from the right. And you see how this goes. And I just grab this here and move it over. I can start removing things. And let's go over here from the right to the left. Now let's time that out and see what that looks like. Let's drag it back over and play. So you can put a timer anywhere. You can grab it and move it around, whatever you want to do. But at the same time, you can change a lot of this over here. I can also do work over here, positioning, and then there are some advanced controls down here. If I want to do a freeze frame, I'll take it to where I want to start that freeze frame, and I'll go ahead and grab a cut tool. I'm going to cut it there, and we'll end the freeze right there. Go back over here, select that, right-click this. I'll go up to change clip speed. This should be shortcutted, so I'm going to put a shortcut here. I just reinstalled this so I don't have it now. Click on that. I'm going to go down here to freeze frame instead of going to, of course, speed change and all that, and click change. So let's see how that looks. You play it back, spacebar. It's going to stop right there and then continue. Okay, let me show you how to do basic tracking. Then there's planar tracking, and then in the new studio version, there is smart tracking. But let's go over here and we're going to bring down these cars. And what I want to do is I want to track a red car in here. So I'm going to go up here and I want to track this red car until it leaves the frame and then put a call out on top of it. Now you can track multiple things here, but once it gets right there, I can cut that. So let's cut it. And make sure these are linked so they cut together. Highlight that. Backspace. So now we have our basic clip. I'm going to come over here to Fusion. I'm going to press Shift plus Spacebar. I'm going to get a Select Tool menu. In this Select Tool menu, just type Tracker. Here's your Planar Tracker. Here's your Tracker. We'll do that one next. Add it. And this is really easy to do. And once I have that tracker, click on it till it turns red. I like to use my arrow keys on my keyboard to use this. You can do whatever you want to do. And place it right over the car. Like that. Now, we can change a lot of things here. The width, the height, so you can play with these settings as well. I just want to show you how to do this basically. As you can see, I'm in the headlight of the car, and that's what I'm tracking. Now, there is something called, if I hold Shift and Spacebar again, there's something called Grid Warp. This allows you to microscopically go into the grid and change this. If you change it to selected, I can change the point sizes of that grid, and I can highlight exactly what I want to focus on. And there's a lesson below on this. I'm not going to do that here, but check that out. I'm going to delete that if you want to learn that. Now, I can also track multiple cars. So if I added another tracker here, add tracker. And now here's a second tracker. Right, so I can add a multiple tracker and add it, but we're not going to do that here. Tracker there and set. Move it up over a little bit more. All I want to do here now is go over here to where it says track forward from current. Press that. So I could have zoomed in a little bit more on that red car. And that's what I mean by using these things down here. But that's okay. In addition to tracking it forward, what you also want to do is track it backwards. Press OK to that. We'll go over here and we'll track it in reverse all the way back to the beginning. So that's because I highlighted the car to the left a little bit too much. So there's my red car. So that's easy fix, no problem. Let it go all the way back. Press OK. and that's still going to look pretty good. So now what I want to do is put a call out over here. So select nothing. T is for text. Let's bring that down. Grab this end of the connector and connect it to that. Now we'll go over here to our text box and we'll type in red car. We'll go back down here to our tracker. I'm going to go up here to operation, click on that, go to operation again, and match move. So I'm going to match the text to the car. Go over here to the text, click on the text box, grab the red little arrow here and move it up and over. See if I can grab it here. And up and over the car. Then we're going to reduce the size, of course. And now move it to it slightly off the frame, like the car is. Once it turns red, you can move it like that. That's what we'll do. So now we'll play that back. Control F is in frame. So there's a small adjustment there. Let's go back over here to my tracker. And that track's a little bit too off, much off to the... So I can move my tracker here just by grabbing it. Let's go a little bit more to the right on this tracker. That's what we'll do. We'll go back to our track over here. And we're going to retract that. So if you make a mistake, you can go back and correct it. What I should have did is really made everything really small into that red car, maybe into the headlights. But I just want to show you how to do this, and then if you make a mistake, how to correct it, because that's how you really learn how to edit. So that should be a lot better. And we still have everything else in place. So let's take it back. Give it a second to reset itself. And you'll see everything here in a second. All right, now let's try it again. Spacebar, way better. So that's how we track and that's how we correct tracking for basic tracking. Now I'll show you planar tracking. And remember, Studio has what they call auto tracking. And we'll press Control F here back on our screen. Let's go back to the beginning. And let's press Control F on our screen and see what this looks like full screen. So let that render. I can see that needs to render a little bit. But something else I can also do is if I wanted to just bounce this video, I can right click it. And of course, before I render this, I want to optimize the media. You can also render this in place. So you can just render it out and what that means is you can just bounce this one particular frame out and then bring it back in. And we can do things like glow, and there's a lot of special effects that you can go up to the library or the effects library and drag down as well. If you see this, to get rid of it, just click on this box right here. If you're not working with media files, get rid of your media files so you can see what you're doing. If you're not using effects at the time, get rid of those. So now you just have a clean worksheet. DR17 lesson, I did this with the Mercedes-Benz keyframe, one frame, well, three or four frames at a time, but you get the point. And I also spun the logo and did different things like that. So if you want to learn more about keyframing as well as tracking or coupled with tracking, check out that lesson. Okay, let's talk about tracking. Now, in the new DaVinci Resolve 18, there's something called surface tracking, one, two clicks and you're in. But in the free version, and also in 17, you have to do it this way. So what we're going to do is we're going to bring down a clip of a paraglider. I'll pop him in right there, hold shift and backspace, and that's our paraglider. Now I want to start the clip where he's in the frame, so I'm going to move down the timeline a little bit, about right there, and we're going to cut that. So we're going to hold shift and backspace to get rid of that. Then this clip is a little bit too long as well, so we'll stop tracking him about right there. Let's go ahead and trim that. And again, I provided assets for every lesson that I'm doing here. You can use mine or use your own. Now we have that, we're going to jump over here to Fusion. So I'm going to click on this, and this is my video. That's all it is. This is the output. That's all that is. If I hold Shift and Spacebar, I'm going to get a Select Tool menu. I have three monitors, so it popped on another monitor. And I'm going to go ahead and click Add. That's going to pop in a node right here. You want to make sure you have this selected. If you have this selected, this is going to appear on the right side. You want this in between the two, okay? So now we're just going to track this guy. So once I click on this, I go up here to Inspector. If you don't see this, just go ahead and click on Inspector. I want to make sure that this is on track. I want to make sure that this is on hybrid. If you have something that's a little bit edgy or pointy, you might want to use point. You can play around with this. If you have things that are moving and looking at motion, you can try different perspectives here or different options here. I'm going to go with perspective here, no problem. Then what I'm going to do is I'm going to go up and take my video back to the beginning. And this is where I cut it. See the yellow line? So we can start there. And we can start here at frame number 40. Now I'm just going to hold Shift and left click and start creating using the bezel tool and just create a circle around what I want to track here. Now right here, what you're going to do here is hold Shift and O as an open to close that polygon. If it's not closed, it won't track. So now we're pretty much set. We're at the beginning of the clip. So now we can say set that, and that's going to set at 40. See where it starts at? I'm going to go down to here where it says track to end, and I'm going to go ahead and click on this. As you can see, it's tracking. And the green lines around my paraglider. That's what we're looking for. It's going to track all the way to the end of the clip. So now we should be okay. So I'm going to go back over here and I'm going to click on Create Planar Transform. And that's going to create that. I'm going to connect this to that. Then if I go back over here to my edit screen, I'm not worried about it tracking perfectly. I just want to show you how this works. And if I hit Control F, I'll go full screen. And as you can see, it's tracking our paraglider. And the difference is, and we'll go back to the beginning here, Control F. So you can see that there is no tracking there and it's just going away from us. So that did track okay. And sometimes you can make this circle smaller to make sure you have a good grip on what you're trying to track. Speed ramping. Let's go over speed ramping really quickly. I gave you this footage of basketball players, and you can use whatever you like. I'm going to bring that down to my timeline. Now I'm going to right-click on the video clip. I'm going to make sure I check retime curve and retime controls. Once I do that, I'm going to click right here and get a menu. I'm going to uncheck retime frame and check retime speed. Now you should see a line down here. It's going to say 100%. So that's the 100% of the speed of whatever this is. This is actually in slow motion. What I want to do here now is go over here. I'm going to take my timeline down, and I want this part where he crosses this guy over to speed. So I take it back to right there, go over here and click keyframe. No, that's going to come up right there. I'm going to take it over to where I want the speed ramping to stop, and about right there. Click in the middle and click right there. So that's what I want to speed ramp. I have a dot there and a dot there. What I'm going to do at this point is just bring this up. The more I go up, the faster it is. And now you'll see that the speed is 229 versus 100%. If I go over here, I'm going to slow this down even more. Let's click another keyframe. Add another keyframe here, and we'll go about right there, and then we'll end that. And on this one, I have dots here. I'm going to bring that down. Now, these are my dots, like the straight lines. That's this. Or I can go to curves. Normally I click on this, this will come become a curve. So now if I go back and play this, here's how it looks. Control F. And see him speed up. And now he'll slow down even more right over here. Right click on the clip. Go to Retime Curve and Retime Controls. Make sure they're both activated. When you go over here to this drop down menu, make sure that you only have selected Retime Speed, not Retime Frame. Okay? Once you do that, now you go over here to the dot, find where you want to start your either speed ramping or slow it down, and then click on the keyframe here, and then determine where you want that to stop. Add another keyframe, and then now you can play with these settings. And you can go all the way up if you want. 42%, 43%. There's your 100%, 229%, and that's your 300%. Lastly, I want to point out that if I switch from this mode to that mode, I'll get this type of wave. And I can actually grab one of these nodes or dots here and change it. And this one maxed out at 300, but you can go in there and make it, you can be 500, whatever you want to do. Let's talk about color for a second. And we're going to go over color correction. I'm not a colorist, so we're not going to do color grading. Just basic color correction. And then we're going to do some color matching. And I'm going to show you how to apply LUTs. And you can also import your own LUT. So let's go ahead and bring these two pictures back down. You can bring the second picture down. Put it wherever you want, on top or side by side. So these are our two pictures. And I'll bring back our dual screen because now is where we can use that. Let's take off here where it says single viewer mode under workspace. Take that off. Full screen, what this does is up here where you have this white DaVinci Resolve thing, you can go down here and go full screen to take that off. I want to show you that as well. And then let's take this off so we have two screens. So now we can clearly see the color difference in these two screens. So we'll go over here to color, down here, and click on color. And the first thing when it comes to basic changes, and you're looking at contrast, or you can change that here, make it darker or lighter, this color correction stuff. Your temperature, we can change that. And that's the mood of the video. And over here, we can change the tint. And this gives you an idea of lift, gamma, gain, and offset. But if you go over here, right next to the color wheel, you're going to see the HDR gray. Click on that instead, and you'll see dark, shadow, or medium, the mid-tones, light, and global. So that's the best one to go off of. And here I can change anything on a per color basis. So I can go down here and add more green just by grabbing it and taking it down. I can reset that right here. You can change your temperature, your tint, change the color itself, the hue, contrast, all. And these kind of work together, these two. But play around with that. Or you can just go down here and just use this. So same thing here will be your dark tones, your medium tones, and your darker tone. A lot of this stuff gets complicated, and I do go over that in my DaVinci Resolve 17 lesson. So you can refer back to that. But this will be just basic color grading. So in this picture, we know it's just too light for one. So I'll add some darkness to it here in the middle. I can also just create new nodes or points of contrast, and that looks a little bit better. So look at this picture, and we'll do the same thing here, darken it up, Go down it. We can scroll down here. I'm not trying to be perfect here, but you can play around with this. And there are video lessons out there on this, so specifically. And I want to make it a little bit darker. Like that. Let's change the tint just a little bit. How does that look? Go back over here. So what I can do now is, like I said, I can take all these changes I just did to this picture. And if I want to get a little bit darker here. If I want to copy these attributes, which are right here. And color match that to this other picture. There's two ways you can do it, but the easiest way to do it is to just click on the node. Hit Control or Command C as in copy, and just copy and paste it. Then go down to here to this video, hit Control or Command V as in victory, and paste it. So you paste it there, and now you have as close as you're going to get. So let's see what that looks like. So we match the color on here to the color on the second clip. This one right here. And that's how you color match. What you can also do too is once you're looking at something like this, I can hit Control F as in frame to go full screen. Hit Control D to take off the effect I just applied. And then Command or Control D as in David again to bring it back on. If I want to put a LUT in here, I go up here to LUTs. Click on LUT, and they're all kind of LUT. And if I scroll over the LUT, it will show me what it's going to look like in my video. As I also said, you can import your own LUT. A lot of times this red LUT is used for like commercials because it's really bright, and you can change it at that point, but same thing applies here. So if I just take a LUT, right click on it, and say apply to current node. Now I have that LUTs there. And it affects all the LUTs going downstream. If I hit Control C as in cat, and then Control V as in victory, now that LUT is applied to my other clip. Let me show you really quickly how to keyframe, and also how to play with your properties over in the inspector. Now in DaVinci Resolve 17 lesson, I go into details about keyframing. We follow a car, we put a tracker on top of the car, and I show you frame by frame how I did that. But basically it's the same thing here. And if I go over here to the right on the transform, we're gonna play around with zoom in, zoom out on this, and make my logo turn 360. The best way to do it is to click on everything, but I could just click on one thing at a time. So I could just click on this if I'm only keyframing this part. I like to do it all. That way I don't have to worry about, because who knows what I'm going to do right here. But we start with that. Everything's ready to go. What you want to do first is I can move over a little bit down my timeline and then do something. So what we're going to do is make it small and see how the keyframe is already starting. And then move over some more and do something else. I'm going to bring it back up right here. Then I'll go over a little bit more. Over here, I want this to go into a 360 turn. Now, I've done that manually, where you go one frame at a time. Here, just type in 360, and that's going to turn automatically. And then go over a little bit more, and we can move this over to, move it up, and we'll go more, and then we're going to pitch it a little bit, and then we'll go back a little more, and we'll yaw it a little bit. Now what happens is anything you see in any of these fields, if it has a diamond next to it, it's keyframable. So keep that in mind, even compositing. Then we'll go back to the end. And what I'm going to do here is just take everything back to normal. We'll also turn off our little burn there. And that's it. Okay, so all our keyframing's in. And if you see this, you know it's all keyframe. You'll also see a keyframe thing down here. And we can actually adjust it down here as well if we need to. So there's our keyframing. Let's do that again. So as you can see, keyframing is not very difficult. You just have to make sure you do it one step at a time. And I can also do speed ramping in here and add in more things as well. If you watch over here, as I play this, you'll see what's going on. We're going to do a quick horror video intro. So I provided some assets for you. We're going to bring in this guy. And let's switch over to edit mode. We'll bring in our evil clown. And a close-up. Go up here and drop it. Click up here. Shift, scroll up and down. And the order they're going to come in, we don't need this sound. They're going to go in this order. So bring this up to the top. What we're going to do here is we're going to zoom through his eyes. But when I start this, what I don't want to do, let's just remove that so we have a clean workspace, is have the zoom affect all the other videos. So what we're going to do is scroll down here. And when he opens his eyes, that's when we need to zoom through his eyes. Go back to about right here. Let's go frame by frame. The eyes are open. Let's go back to where he closes his eyes. And right there where we should zoom through. So I'll cut that right there. And remove. First, what I'm going to do is bring the picture out. So let's go over here. And let's transform this video. And bring this out so it fills the screen all the way. And we'll do something like that. So let's go back to about right here. And we will make our cut. 4 in the morning, getting a little bit tired, but I gotta finish this video. So I'm gonna click over here on this. And now I can start my dynamic zoom from here. So I'll go over here, click on the drop down menu. Go to dynamic zoom. Remember, it starts on the green and ends on the red. So it's starting there is not what I really want. So I'm going to move this out to the edges. Then I'm going to come down to the red. Click on the red like that. And click on the corner here and move it in. And move it over his eyes like that. We can make that smaller. Like that. So what we should have is a zoom into his eyes and they open. That's what we want. We want that now to go into the crazy clown. And let's, before we do that, go back over here and transform the clown. Let him fill the screen. And good, it's not zooming in. So what I'm going to do, I want that to zoom into his eye. Right there. Take my cut tool here, razor blade, and cut that. Let's see how that looks. There we go. So that's going to be a little shocking effect. But what we have to do though is make another cut right here. What I'm going to do instead is I'm going to start big and go back into his eyes. So I'm going to go back up here to dynamic zoom. We're going to start more out here, and let's find the red inside here. Move this over, find the red, and let's zoom in. Put it on his eye, and move that green back over. Let's see what that looks like. Spacebar. Way too long. Let's shorten it up. That's about all we need. Bring it in. I wanted to go frame by frame here to see where I'm at. And that has to be smaller. and more in his eye. And there's my zoom through there. And let's find our last clip. This one, we're going to do some speed wrapping here and things like that, but I just want to kind of get things lined up here. Because once he goes here, I want this to start on him coming out like this. And then go out here. So once he hits the wall, we can stop that. Now we're going to do a series of jump cuts. So I'm going to cut that there. And we're going to speed ramp that. I'll go down here and we can just cut that. That's why it's called a jump cut. So we're going to cut that. Shift delete. Now he should be coming at us. That's what we want. And give this time to process. I'm going to go back over here to transform. And make sure we're outside the frame. Here too. Okay. So now he's coming at us. So that's what we want. Just need to speed ramp that. So what I'm going to do here. Let's hit Control plus R, and I start my speed change. I'm going to right-click this. I'm going to go up here, click on this. So now I have both of them. I'm going to click on this right here, this right here. I'm going to uncheck retime frame and check retime speed. So I'm going to retime the speed, and I'm just going to drag this all the way up. Shift backspace and see what we have. So we can speed ramp this as well. So let's go back to right click and click on retime curve, retime controls and retime curve. Go down here, unselect retime frame, and we're going to select retime speed. Drag this along, because what I want to do is start speeding that up right about there. So I'll put a keyframe right there. And let it run all the way out. It's going to be a little bit unrendered, but from right here, I'm going to drag this up. Like all the way up there. Okay, let's see what that looks like. Let's hit Control F, start from the beginning. So let's go back over here, and we're going to our guy's nose for some reason. So let's fix that. Let's go back over here to dynamic zoom. And there we go. We're on the nose. Let's click on that and take it back up to his eye where it should be. Now let's try that out. Try that. Let's go back a little bit. So let's bring this in a little bit to focus more on him. And let's go back. There we go. That's a little better. And that's that jump cut I put in. I think you get the point. I'm going to bring in a few sound effects. So we'll start with the music. It's called 3,000 Years Old. Turn the volume up. I can bring in our mixer up here. And check my volumes. Let's see what that sounds like. So right there, we have to bring in the sound effect. Let's go back and we'll bring in, right? Something cool like that. Let's pop it below it. And let's see what that sounds like. Came way too late. Pop it over a little bit. And right there we should have a clown in. So I'm going to bring in my clown laughing. Evil clown. Bring him down here in the bottom. I'm going to cut this right here just so I can see what's going on. So the video clip is way too long. Let's delete that. Let's see where we are. Clown should come in a little bit sooner. Like right after the eye opens. Something like that. And then we're going to bring in some more stuff. We'll bring in another hit sound right here. And line it up with that. Then we'll just cut it to about right there. Let's go back to the beginning. And here we'll have a better idea of what we need to do. Again, I'm not trying to make this perfect at all. Let's go Control F. And press the play. Press play. So now we need to add more ending to that. This over here. So that's how we kind of build that up. But the goal here was to teach you how to do the zoom through or zoom through someone's eyes. And it's really simple to do. Put it all together and see what we have. I did make a few more changes to this in terms of bringing in music to match what was going on with the video. And I would have put more effort into the color grading to make it look more like a horror movie, a horror trailer. But I just wanted to show you how to do the zoom through and do it nice and quick. So this is what it looks like now. Okay, let's talk about masking. I provided you with two assets. One is a guy walking. We'll bring him down. And then we have, let's get rid of the audio. Let's bring the second guy down who is running or jogging. Pop him up, bring him underneath. We don't know where he's going to go yet. Depends on how we mask out this. So what I'm going to do first is cut this because this clip is really long. We'll cut that about right there. You can use the clip I gave you or choose any one you want. And that will make you force you to think a little bit outside the box as we do this. That's sufficient. Now this guy is going the wrong way. So let's go over here to Inspector. If you don't have it selected, select it. And come on down to flip right here. Let's flip him. Now he's going the same direction. And normally I would want them to be about the same because this guy is on the right side of the video the whole time. In the beginning, this guy is way back here. So let's cut it right there. And normally I will make sure that their heights are the same and all that stuff. It's just a video if I have to. Let's delete that. So once we have this, now we're pretty much set. What I want to do now is go down here to color. Color. Click on that. This is my node. And this is really simple stuff. I'm going to keep it very, very, very clean. So here I have a serial node. If I want to add another node, I can do that. Or press Alt or Option plus S as in Sam. If I have two nodes, they're connected to my correctors here. See, corrector one, corrector two. I don't need that second node. So if you have more than one node up here, you're going to see multiple correctors. Once I have this set, I'm going to right click on this screen and go down to Add Alpha Output. You're going to get a blue dot right there and a square dot right there. A square blue dot right there. I'm going to go down here to Window. Click on that. Go down here to Pen. This pen is down here. I'm going to click on that. I'm going to invert. As I write that masking line or whatever masking shape I use, I can soften it or transform it right here. So you can put, I don't know, 0.75, whatever you want to put here. I'll put just one, just simple. And you can adjust it as you see it because it's going to show you, you know, whether it's feathered or softer or not. Now, next to my corrector here, number one, This is my keyframing. So I need to keyframe out the picture. Now I actually chose the wrong picture. So let's go get the right picture. There we go. Now let's go back. This still should be set. So I'm going to go over here and set alpha. Add alpha output. So I'm doing this one more time. This way you remember it better. Go down here to power or power window. Pan right down here. And then we have inversion. Invert that. Now I'm going to come over here and I'm going to select or turn on my keyframing. Pretty simple. Now we can just start with our masking. So if I just scroll up on the mouse, picture gets bigger and vice versa. And what I want to do is create a mask that will cover the entire frame at the end. Go down to where I want the mask to start. So we'll start the mask about right there. And what we can do at this point is just take our pen here. And we need to create a box. The cool thing about this, it's like the Bezier tool. So I click it here, it closes. Cool thing about this is if I click anywhere, I can create more nodes and I can shape this any way I like. And some of you guys are really good at this, so I know this is not going to be a problem at all. And then let's shape it so I can come up here, grab the end of this node and line it up the way I want it. About right there. Right there. Nah, I'm not going to use that. I need a clean line. So let's go over here. I can use that line right there. So let's go ahead and take a clean line. As long as whatever we're lining out all the way across or all the way down the screen in any angle or shape, you're fine. So I'm going to line this up here. And we'll just shape out the pink right there. It doesn't have to be perfect. I'm not going to do this perfectly. I think you're going to get the point when I'm done. But you want to take your time with yours. Remember, there's 24 frames in a second, so you have to have some patience with this. But the goal is when we're done, I can click in the middle. I can turn this around any way I want as well, too. Let's take that back. And when we're done, our goal is to have this totally blacked out. And we can't see anything until we connect this dot, but let's go ahead and get started. So I'm going to take this back to the very beginning, and that's where we're going to start. So now what we have to do is go frame by frame. So I'm going to use the arrow key. 1, 2. And now the masking starts right there. And I'm not going to worry about an exact shape. Now let's bring it back. And let's go one step at a time. And then we'll move this over one step at a time. And I'm going to do this fast so it's going to be really choppy. But basically we're keyframing. Over and then bring this over. And whatever we have, let me connect this blue dot here. If I grab this blue square and drag it down to the blue dot and just let it go, now you can see how it blacks out first picture. So it masks out. So my goal is to totally mask out this picture at the end of this frame. To remove that, click it. When it's blue, it's going to remove it. We have to put that on at the end. As you can see, my keyframes are being made down here. I'm going to do this quick, so I'm going to go 3 and then move it over. So remember that there are 24 frames per second, so you really want to take your time with this, but I'm not doing it. I think you get the point already. I'm going to speed this up. This is where we start our masking right here, the main masking from this guy. Now that I think we're done with this, and again, it's going to be choppy and all that, so keep that in mind. We're going to go back here and make changes to it as well. Now we can grab the line here and connect the blue square to the blue dot. So you see, this is covering all the way. So I was showing you at the beginning what that did. So I guess it took a keyframe on that. So now we can make that change. Let's get this out of the way here. Now we should be good to go. Because I showed you that and I forgot, since I had keyframing on, if I go back, forward, up and down, that's going to keyframe. So keep that in mind. Again, this is imperfect. That's why I did it this way, so we can go back and make changes. Because doing it this way, you'll really get a better grip on it versus just flying through a lesson and going, oh, I got it. So here we go. Let's go back over to the edit page. Because I know that the transition starts right away, I'm going to move the guy, the runner, underneath him. Sometimes it will be at the end. Depends on how you do the transition. Go full screen, spacebar. So that's not perfect, but I think you get the point. And remember also that transitions are normally going to be really quick. Yeah, so once he comes in, then you can just cut the other guy. So now bring this all the way back. And then that transition itself, you can speed bump it. So select them both, call Control R as in red. And now I have speed bumps on both of them. Right click, go up to Retime Curve. Go over here. Let's get this, make this bigger. Let me put that in the same frame. Let's go over here. So click on this to make sure that we have all that in the same frame. There's a lot here. Click on this button. I showed you this before. Unselect Retime Frame and select Retime Speed. So now I can just take this and I can add in a keyframe here. You say I want this to start here or there. I showed you that earlier. I'm just going to bump all this up. Then we have to bump the other one up as well. But if I do this faster, it's not going to sync up with this one. So you want to make sure that we do the same thing over here. Select both. Come over here, come down, unselect Retime Frame, select Retime Speed, and let's bump it up too. Then I can just take this, it's at 100% right now, and just bring it up too. See what that looks like. It's just a faster transition. What I can also do is just bounce it out or export it and then bring it back in and then do one speed change on both. But yeah, then they both should sync up pretty good. Check it out. Let's see what we got. So that's still slow for a transition because most transitions are 3 to 5 seconds long. But I think you get the point and you know how to do this now. And remember, with that bezier tool, whatever you call it, you can make any kind of shape you want. So your transition can be really cool. And this is also a way to have what they call a seamless transition. The first way that you can do a multi-screen or split-screen DaVinci Resolve is to use a video collage. So if you go to Effects, come down to OpenFX, and type in video on the search, you'll find video collage. If I stacked up four videos, if I were doing a 4x4 here, I would have this. What I can do is go up to Effects, go down here, and I have all these things I can change. So I can change the roundness of corners. I can also add columns and add rows and things like that. But this takes time. And to learn this is a lesson within itself. So I linked the lesson below on this. I think the guy did a great job, but this is just too long. It's not very complicated, but it takes a lot of time. So I'll let him explain that because I think he did a great job on it. I'm going to move on to a more manual, quicker way to do this. We're going to do a 4x4, 2x2, and a 3x3. Now let's move on to split screens. So if I enlarge this over here, what we'll see is this. So if I have a 1920x1080 video, if I wanted four screens, I will make them each 960x540. 1, 2, 3, 4. If I wanted three videos, they would be 640 by 1080 vertical. If I wanted to have one big picture and then two pictures on this side, this picture will be 960 by 1080. And these two pictures will be 960 by 540. If I just wanted two videos on each side, if I wanted to be precise in my measurements, they will be 960 by 1080 each. just to give you an idea of how the grid works. And what you could do is create a simple grid like this and use that as a template. So you can put it behind or in the bottom of all your tracks and then just place your videos where they're supposed to go. That's one way. Another way you can do this is if I take this off, I can go up to Effects. And what I want to do is go down and find an adjustment layer and bring it in. And the adjustment layer, anything I put on this is going to be on all my clips. So I could bring in at this point a grid. So if I go down to OpenFX and I search and I type in grid, I can pop a grid onto my adjustment layer like that. If I go to Inspector, go to Effects, I can adjust that grid anywhere I want to. And again, this would be steps, but at least I can use this to put my videos on. So you can try that as well. But what I would do is something more like this. First, we're going to look at how to do a picture with a border. And this is just one way to do it. I'm going to go over here to generators. And I could use a gradient color here, or I can use a solid color. So I'm going to go with a solid color, and I'm going to bring that solid color down. So I have this solid color, and it's black. I can make it any color I want to make it. I'm going to make it red so it can stand out. I'm going to do a 4x4 grid here. So I'm going to bring down my first video, unlink the audio, and delete the audio. Delete any extra frames right here or any extra tracks. Sorry about that. Now we'll bring down our second video. And do the same thing. And we'll bring them all down just one by one. What I like about doing it manually is that, as you can see, my videos are all different lengths. So sometimes that's a problem, but I can shorten them all to be the same length. And usually you want the shortest video to be the length of all the other videos. So I'm just going to do that now. So that's what we have so far. And we'll make these tracks smaller. Now I can get rid of this over here. And that's what we have. So I have an extra audio track. I need the room. Let's go up here. So we have our first video up here on top. Click on the video. Click over here and click on transform. So now I can just take her, and I know about what 960 by 540 is. If I put her in the corner here and bring this down, so that's one. Click on the second one. We're going to do this four times. I'm not going to do this perfectly, but it's not really difficult to do. But I like the fact, again, that I can control all the videos and do all the color corrections. And the best way to do it is start over here in the corner and drag over this way, because they're going to meet at some point. I'm going to leave a little bit of room because I want to create borders this way and have the solid color, the red, come through all the videos. I could have a video underneath this as well, anything I want. And you can trim it and measure it out. But as you can see, though, we still have that red in there. So if I Control F this and played it back, that's what we would have. So that's just a quick way to do multi-screen. It's going to take a little more effort, of course. So I'll make sure that the red goes all the way over. And that's only one way to bring in a border. And you would just take your time and do the border. You can also go down here and work with some more things. And there's a lot of things you can do down here, so have fun with that. If I went with the 2x2, I would take these two videos here. If I click on video, all the videos will change up and down. So we have two. So what we're going to do here is, a couple of ways we can do this. One is, we need to go out to the full screen for both of them. And let's go over here to this one, It's going to be the same thing. We go full screen. I know I'm doing this quick, but I think you're getting the points. So that's kind of what we want to split screen. Let's take this one and move it out. If we have a side-by-side video, we can keyframe this one to come in or pop in or fade in, and we can put a transition on it. So we can do different things with this. So this one's over here, and that one's over there. So let's take this and move it back in the middle. Let's click on the top video here. And transform it and put it in the middle of the frame and square it up. We can also just have it fit to the screen. So this one's over here. Let's put that one in the frame. So now there's a couple things we could do. One thing we don't want to do is have this much space above her head, unless there's, you know, text over here or reason for it. And this one we have a little bit of space. What I could do is crop this one and move it up a little bit, or just move it down like that. Move it up like that a little bit, because you want your videos to be almost the same. So that's a better match. A little bit too much, let's see, more like that. So I'm going to click on this video. I'm going to go up here to effects, and we'll get rid of that. Let's go to open effects, and let's type in drop shadow. We can drop a shadow on either of these clips. And this is a different way to get a line, something between the video clips. Once I drop that shadow, I'll go up here to effects. And here I can change the color of that, and we can make it blue. Then I can change the lines of it and click OK. Now you can't see it right now, but let's go ahead and take the blur off. There's going to be a drop angle to the clip. Now what I want to do is I want to go up to the clip, to the video, and I want to trim this a little bit. I'll go down here to crop, and I'll crop it left and crop it right. Then we can move it over. If I come down to the second video, I'll do the same thing. I'll crop it left, and I'll crop it right. I can also go back to the transform tool and crop it here as well. But that's going to move the whole, that's going to change the picture itself. So we just want to use this tool for now. Let's go out. And now let's move it over. So once I get here, they should both be on the screen. This has some blue. I can put this on top of this one. I just have both pictures up at the same time. So if I stack them up, this is what you would have. So that gives you two basic pictures side by side. If you wanted to have her come in later, what you could do is move her over like this. Have her go about right there. But see, what I would do is keyframe this and have her go from a full picture to a half a picture and have her slide over with the keyframing. Then I would come over here and have her keyframed in, which is very simple. Just come to position, click on the keyframe, and then go over 1, 2, 3 down your timeline. Then you can move her over a little bit, and then go down the timeline and move her over a little bit more. But that would start though from out here. So it'll look like this. So she'll just slide in. Borders between them. Go back down here. Go down to your drop shadow. And that's my effect. And that's where you saw the blue coming in right here. So what I would do is make that drop shadow black. Or move her over. Let's see. Okay, there's my shadow. And move her over like that. So now we'll have that color between them. Right there. Then it should pop apart about right there. And now I'll play it back. Let's see what we have. Okay, so that's keyframing over. So that's okay, but you get my point. And I know I'm not going over this in detail, but at least you know how to get started with this and start playing around with it. Okay, so lastly, I'm going to show you how to bring in three videos at once. Let's pop them up, and now we're doing a 3x3. So now we can bring them all down at the same time. Bring them all down to your timeline. Let's go over from cut to edit. We can remove any audio. And give this a second, because this has to render. Let's bring this up on top. Let's bring this one on top of this one. Make sure all the videos are the same length. So we know pretty much we're going to be 640 by 1080 on these, but we can also leave room around, a border around these videos as well. So I'm going to click on one at a time. I'm going to turn the other two off. And give it a second. Come up here to transform. Now I can grab that video and move it over to the right. As you can see, I can leave a border around it if I want to. So Control Z to bring that back up. As you notice, everything takes a few seconds, so just don't be too impatient when you're loading video on top of video. Now I'll turn that one off. I'll turn this one on. Grab it. It's pretty much in the middle. And then we'll do the same for the bottom one. And move it over to the corner. Now let's turn all three on. And there you go. I could put, again, an adjustment layer up here. I could also put a color background behind the videos. I can adjust them. I can have them all go flush together like that, and then just stretch them out. I mean, they don't have to fit perfectly. Something like that. Let's go full screen and see what that looks like. So that will be your three videos in one. And here there's black because I just didn't put those two together. Okay, so it's one, two, three. I want one, just grab that one. We can move it down and move it over. Now let's go Control or Command F as in Frank. So that's pretty smooth. What I also like about this is that I can feather the edges there as well. But what I like about this too is that now I can go into color and all of my video clips are here. So say if I go over here and I do some color correction on this, maybe pop it out a little bit more. I don't know. We'll just do anything. Then I can copy, paste, paste. That's how we do a color matching and a little color correction with this. Of course, I didn't do it correctly, but I think you get my point. So if I go back over here now to my edit page and I hit Control or Command F and play it back. Now I color matched all the videos, at least. Not in a good way, but you get my point. I can look at all the videos and I can match them up and cut them and, you know, chop them up and change the volumes if they have volume to them. Just go to the audio section. And I may want this to be the main volume. I can have this one fly in from the top and spin around in. There's so many things you can do. When you get to the end, I can have this one fade to black. So you can do a lot of stuff using keyframing as well. But at least you know how to do this manually. So that'll about do it. At least it gives you a basic idea of how to use DR18. If you want to get deep into DaVinci Resolve 18, There are links below to other people who I think are really, really good. And there's thousands of lessons out there on DR17 and 18. Enjoy, check out my other lessons. Please subscribe, like the video, and you have a creative day.